That's life. Now, what should be the general picture? What should be the general picture? The general picture.
So just to justice.
I didn't say what is the admissible and what is the H1. I didn't say that.
So if your torus is split,
yes,
it would be used to just home on the.
Absolutely. Region. If the torus is split, then it's just a product of GL1.
No gamma action.
And there is no gamma action, and this is just a GL1 story n times. Just a product of J1.
But does it mean that for non-abelian groups, you also should have something instead of
yeah. Does that mean anything?
No.
So I didn't say what is the H1. So on this guy, I said I have a gamma action. So the gamma action is here. There is no gamma action on the C star, of course, C cross. Even if you look at real things, it's just a coefficient. It's just a coefficient system. It's a neutron. As I said, it would be Q and bar. And the WF maps to gamma. So this gives you an action of WF to this. So H1 means what? Well, it means exactly what they are. If you want me to define the H1. Yeah, but it's no big deal here. Okay, there are cocycle, one cocycle, classes of one cocycle. And I say admissible because I want some at least some continuity. I need a continuity assumption. So here admissibility is just a continuity of the cocycle. So it's continuous coverage. It's not any coverage. Okay. Now what should be the general picture? Now there is a real jump. So the real jump is what? We should have a reciprocity map for P and F, so as before. So it should go from H1 with some admissibility condition I will explain in more detail here, from WF to G check. I will explain what is G check. So the dual complex dual. This should map to automorphic representation for G F, always the complex coefficient. But up to some equivalence, which is called L indistinguishability. It cannot be a map if you don't go to some equivalence. Here you have pass to the so-called L packets. It's only for packets of representation, of automorphic representation, that the contextual map can make sense. So, already for J2, it's never surjective. It's never surjective. Yeah, because I have taken WF. So even in the local case, this is not enough.
So you still need to go to where the link?
Yes. So it's not. So for GLN, L packets are singletons. So this question does not show up. I will explain what. Let me say just in a word. I have drawn a picture for SM2 with guys around that, guys here. Well, these guys, and these are end packets. when for SL2. For SL2, when you discrete series come show up by pairs, those pairs of discrete series, basically the same parameter, these pairs are L packets. But you really, if you want to have some kind of reciprocity map, you have to put together objects that are in the same L packet. That's already necessary for SL2. For GL2, for GLN, L packets are fortunately single. Only one element. So you have no problem. So now, this is expected to be true. But I tell you what is poor. Not much. What is poor?
I understand what the reducible
sense,
in this case,
it's just
Yes, in this case, of course, it's clear.
Yeah.
I believe behind that there is more general.
Yes,
but no, okay. Just say that in general case,
for an arbitrary group, yes. You will say that it's not reducible if it comes in the Lebesgue. So here, so this is the theorem by Harris Taylor and the theorem by Harris Taylor. So, and from that you can reconstruct, as I said, of course, that's really the same. Right? Well, you can use, if you want, the Wendelin group. So the Wendelin, the so-called Wendelin, but I forgot to say what is G hat, so sorry. So let me return to what is G change. So, G, I look at given G, I have a G star. What is G star? This is a quasi-split inner front. So for GLN, GLN is split, so G is G star. Now, to G star, together with you choose in G star, for G star, choose, comment dire, an épinglage. Generally, the French word, épinglage. Which means you choose a ball, some group, you choose a torus inside it. So the star means that the link is this star. Or maybe you write it as a BB or BP, depending on what notation you prefer. And you also choose a root vector for all alpha, for all positive roots. So, or at least simple roots. With respect from the two of T to in B. So you have simple roots and you look at those guys. So you have also the dual object with a simple corpus. You have also the X star alpha, the simple corpus. So maybe, I'm asking too much. I'm asking too much. Now I have the set of simple roots, that's enough, and the set of corpus. Okay, so with this I guess I have enough, or even I have the lattice of generated by roots and the lattice generated by corpus. If I remember correctly, is that enough? Or maybe I need delta and delta GH. Yeah, I need also these objects. Okay. Yeah, sorry. To these guys, I attach Z module is dual, a basis, the dual basis, and the basis for corpus. So once I know that, I have canonically the set of characters, the set of co-characters, the set of simple roots, and the set of simple roots. So, to G star, I attach up to some choice, but this is G star defines such an object. Now you reverse. You reverse that and you define G Chesh corresponds to X star. So X lower star here. X lower star. You replace the delta the delta. But over the complex, as a complex. In fact, it would be better, that's the traditional notation. Myself, I would prefer to write G-Chesh of C. Because G-Chesh is really defined over Z. And so you can put inside whatever thing you want. So, instead of G-Chesh, which is traditional, I would prefer to write G-Chesh of C. Because simply, it's just the root daemon, you take the dual one, so it gives you some object defined over Z, in fact. So, as a scheme, it's defined over Z. And you take the complex one. So, G-Chesh, or rather, G-Chesh of C. Okay? So, that's for G-Chesh. So, for example. Example. So one remark. When you go to an inner form, you don't make any difference for the G-check. The G-check, so this object doesn't see if the group is split or not. Quasi split or not. If you go to an inner form, this is the same object. While here it's really very different. So it's not even clear that the map is defined. In fact. So it should make sense for G quasi split. So it would be better here to assume you have to pass it like that and to have a map. Otherwise you have to reduce the admissibility condition. We take care of the fact that you take an inner form. So it's a subtle point here.
Sorry, maybe you will write the definition of each one with this in this way. I believe it being preserved.
No. It's admissible.
Admissible?
Yeah, there is some admissibility condition.
Maybe you write the definition.
Admissibility condition. Well, I can tell you a few of the subparts. First, you need a continuity. Okay? But for example, in general, you don't want something like I will write you something which is not admissible. Okay? So you take WF. So when you have X in WF, you always have the absolute value. You have the absolute value of WF. Now you can take the following map. Log of absolute value of X. 0, 1. This is not admissible. You need some semi-simplicity assumption. So it contains the admissibility condition. I don't want to describe them because I will forget what that means. So it contains semi-simplicity conditions, continuity conditions, and also conditions that come from G with respect. The difference between G and G star, the quasi-split inner form, this has to be taken care of in the admissibility condition.
But sorry, this magic looks like when you go to the great equilibrium.
No, it's not. It's a different game.
No, I understand.
It's a different game. This would be. This would also be forbidden. Even for the later. No, no, it's a different.
So this is what you wanted to avoid.
Yeah. So if you want to introduce the vector in group, so maybe I should say that it's vaguely conjectural that there should be a group L of F, as we call the long group. Together with a map, the London group should have a map to WF, a surjective map, as the WF has a map to the Galois group, not always surjective. But here, what we need should be surjective, probably. And at least there is a guess of what is LF for local field. So instead of here WF, you could put LF here. It should be a better approximation, so you should have a bigger image. The point is only to these objects don't exist really. They exist only through their representation, through their automorphism. So the only object that makes sense is this the H1 admissible. That's really what makes sense.
Ah.
And so the LF, so now let me tell you, the LF is likely to be equal to WF if F is Archimedean. For complex representation. So in fact, it includes the fact that you are looking at complex representation. So it's, I'm not really satisfied with that object. So it might be WF, it's one way to present it to SU2 for F local non-Archimedean. This is a variant of the so-called Bellinelli group, but this is a way which is completely unnecessary to use. Well, it's a variant. Again, the only thing that is important is the set of representations of this class.
Is it Weyl R4? Weyl R4?
No, no. Okay. It's a different. It's again a different thing. Yes. The story is terrible.
R4 is S2. You
can also say SL2C if you want. But then, when the homomorphisms are assumed to be holomorphic on the SM2C complement, you should say SU2 is just continuous homomorphism. If you say SM2C, you ask for holomorphic maps. So it's a part of the admissibility condition which depends on what group you are looking at. So I'm sorry, it's very bad, but that's fine. And the Hauser condition shows up in the global situation. So you will have an extra SU2 or SM2C, whatever, in the global case. So, well, but let me say, as far as I understand, there is no really satisfactory formulation for the general case.
For the functional fields,
yes, of course. This is the point I wanted to make, but of course you know that very well. So in the functional field case, then, in fact, it's true that the object has function field, so it's global. Then you can look at LF as being the WF times SU2, but then it's the after SU2. And
so this is
it's a complicated story because. You have a kind of duality between the local one and the global one. So And some days it makes sense to look locally at WF times SUT times SUT. One is after, the other one is the mean. And flipping the two is what is called sometimes Atari over duality. It's related to the duality. So typically, you may think of the trivial representation and the standard representation. They have some kind of non-Archimedean local field, whatever characteristic. So when you think of the trivial representation and the standard representation, if you flip them, this is an instance of Auber duality. This has been discovered by other people before. So I don't know the history of this. And this amounts to flip the two copies of the SUT. So it's a complicated story. So to my taste, in any case, it's difficult to have really a natural formulation of the general. Up to now, it's not clear what should be the general, the best general formulation. But to my taste, the reciprocity law really works for WF. That's the key observation. If we knew the reciprocity law the way I formulated it, with WF, the other things are much easier to take care of. So it should describe the most important part of the Langlands model. So of course, I didn't say, but you all know that Brinfeld and Laforgue have succeeded in establishing the dictionary for function fields. So Brinfeld for J2.
This is okay.
Yes. So for function field, you have theorized by Ringfeld, generalized by Laforgue, based on Ringfeld construction of Schuckens. So, but you are a better expert than me on this subject, so I would not dare to discuss that in detail without preparing seriously the lecture, which I did. Well, I didn't try the lecture literature. So, as regards more general groups, let me say a few things. So I said, for example, I didn't discuss this thing, so for GLM, the G-chesh of C is GLM C. You may forget for C for the moment. I don't look at other cases. If G is SNM, then G-check is P-GLM C. It reverses center and cosine because you have the duality here. You replace this by this, so it changes adjoint group to simply connected group. SL is simply connected, this one is adjoint. So if you take G is SPN or SP2N, now people write it. Then you check is SO 20 plus 1 C and conversely. And I don't know for G equals SO 2N, then I'll let you do that as an exercise. I'm afraid to see you.
Make the same.
So if I say spin, spin to N, then V check is P fuel cell. And so on. So, okay, no big deal here. So this split case, I would like at least to tell you about the non-split. But what is split? Guy. What is split? So if D is UN on volatile expansion, here on graph is quadratic, you get the unitary, the quasi-split unitary group related to E over F, then G check is what? Then this is GN C, but with a non-trivial action of gamma or E over F, which gives you the WF action. And the non-trivial action is as that, so if you have gamma E over F is 1 plus sigma, then you say that sigma of x is minus 1 to the n transpose x minus 1 goes to 4, minus 1 to the n. And I insist it's not transpose of x minus 1. It's really this one, because you want that the gamma action preserve the splitting. The gamma action, so I didn't say that, but on G-check, the gamma action must preserve the splitting.
So,
further moment, but we need some more. So for the that's the story for the Moses built guy. This was one example. Now we need to. What's the problem? No.
G is this matrix -1, -1, -1, or
-1 to the
n.
So it's -1, +1, -1, +1 until you arrive at the n, then you change n times the sign. For n equals 3, then j is -1, -1, -1.
Okay.
If you don't put the sign, then the root element will be changed by +1, -1. But they are not present. So that's really the positive. Okay? Well, now if you sort of believe that this thing should make sense, then now I can have everything. Then there is a property. There is a property which is called rigidity. Then in this case, if you have phi automorphic, global, if you have phi automorphic in the global situation, then phi is the restricted tensor product of global objects. This is a general theorem. I didn't quote, but it's a norm. It's not trivial. This is, for example, the fact that the group are of type 1. This has been obtained by Bernstein, if I remember correctly. So it's by no means a trivial theorem. Okay, and the pi ring, this is the new pi. The pi ring are so called unramified for almost all places. This is a trivial fact. This is essentially the admissibility condition. It's just a continuity which is from the index that you have no choice. It's always the case in the local, global point of view that objects we consider are almost everywhere for almost all places, all but a finite number of places. They are unramified in some sense. So, unramified representations are representations that have a nice k invariant vector, kv invariant vector, where kv is the natural maximal compact subgroup in the situation. For almost all v, there is one, because for almost all v, the group is quasi-split, and for almost all v, since it is quasi-split, you can define the hyper-special maximal compact subgroup. And for almost all v, the representation will have a vector fixed under the maximal hyper-special compact subgroup. So, and for this, the theory becomes essentially academic. For such representation, you have at hand. So I expect you have seen that. You have at hand the Satake duality or parametrization or whatever you call it. And this allows you to parameterize the unified representation by just characters of the torus, and they are unramified characters of the torus. So we already described what is the duality for the reciprocity map, what the reciprocity map is for tori, quasi-split tori. So for quasi-split tori, you know the picture. So you know what is Bechtel for unramified for unramified tori. Easy, and in that case it's just getting some power, and or even composing by the norm, which is okay, and but it's just taking some power because of the Frobenius element, just raising some power. So it's completely elementary in that case, and so you know what it should be at unramified places. If it makes sense, it has to be, I didn't say, but the global reciprocity map has to be compatible with the local reciprocity maps. So you know for all those sort of places what should be the base change. And now, for GLM, and this is only for GLM, if you know a representation almost everywhere, then you know it everywhere. An automorphic representation is completely determined by what it is at almost all places. All but a finite number of places determine completely the representation. Unique. So, if ever it exists, what happens at unramified places controls completely the situation. So if the map exists, it's certainly unique. The only question is to define it. So maybe I should stop here and use this automatic injection next time with the ideas of